The land of the five rivers, Punjab, the granary of India. A land of rugged people, of farmers and soldiers. A land of Sufi poetry and the universal truths of the great gurus. Preeminent in this tradition was Guru Nanak, the founder of the Sikh faith, for whom the Himalayas and Makkah and Medina were equally sacred. Early in the 16th century, the great Mughal, Akbar, made a gift of 500 acres of land to Guru Ram Das, the fourth guru of the Sikhs, wished a temple to be built here. The foundation stone was laid by the Muslim divine, Mian Mir of Lahore, and the temple was built under the direction of Guru Arjan Dev, the fifth guru. Two hundred years later, the greatest of the Sikh rulers, Maharaja Ranjit Singh, then at the height of his power, gave the temple at Amritsar its covering of gold. The golden temple at Amritsar is the first place of pilgrimage for the Sikhs. During the First World War, many a family in Amritsar lost young men in Flanders, in Mesopotamia, and in different parts of Europe. The wheat fields of Punjab provided bread for French and English soldiers. In India, there was the awakening of a will to freedom. Into a political arena enlarged by Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Bipin Chandra Pal, and Lala Lajpat Rai, entered the imperishable spirit of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. In 1919, the British government enacted the infamous Rowlatt Act, which empowered the Raj to arrest and imprison Indians without due process of law, a travesty unthinkable to anyone who believed in justice. Gandhi asked the people of India to protest against it. He asked them to observe April the 6th, 1919 as a day of national humiliation, and he asked that every demonstration be non-violent and peaceful. On the appointed day, life in Punjab was brought to a standstill by a massive hartal. In Amritsar, the protest movement was taken up by Dr. Satpal, Dr. Kichlu, Chaudhary Bugamal, and Mahashah Ratanchand. Dr. Satpal and Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu were prohibited from addressing a meeting attended by over 50,000 people. The meeting was addressed by Badrul Islam. On April the 9th, Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs jointly celebrated Ram Navami and took out a huge procession. Hindus and Muslims drank from the same cup at joint drinking booths. This awakening of national consciousness alarmed the British government. Dr. Satpal and Dr. Kichlu were deported from the city. The people of Amritsar, in their anxiety for their leaders, moved in procession towards the Deputy Commissioner's residence to ask for their release. At the railway overbridge near the station, they were stopped by a military picket. The people pleaded that they only wanted to speak to the Deputy Commissioner. Without provocation, the military suddenly opened fire, killing and wounding many people. Soon the crowd lost control and went on a rampage. The general post office was set on fire. The manager of the National Bank was murdered. So was the accountant. the town hall, and the Queen's statue were attacked. The manager of the Alliance Bank opened fire on the agitators, killing some of them. Miss Sherwood, a teacher in a mission school, was needlessly attacked. She was rescued by the family of one of her pupils, but it was too late to stop the wave of antagonism and hatred. When some of the wounded were taken to the civil hospital, the civil surgeon refused them treatment, saying, "Send them to Gandhi." No one was more distressed by the violence than Gandhi. But peace and non-violence were not given a chance, and circumstances moved towards tragedy. Meanwhile, authority had decided on revenge for British bloodshed. The guns of the Govindgarh fort were trained on the city. The Lieutenant Governor, Sir Michael O'Dwyer, sent for troops. They were under the command of General Dyer. Amritsar was handed over to the army. All public meetings were banned. Anyone breaking the curfew was to be shot on sight. However, this order was not communicated to the public. On the 13th of April, Baisakhi Day, the people, Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, moved towards Jallianwala Bagh to attend a hastily arranged meeting. They wanted to express their pain and grief. General Dyer anticipated the protest meeting and moved in his troops. His two armored cars could not pass through the narrow lanes. The meeting was peaceful, but without warning, General Dyer ordered the troops to open fire. However much the British loved their empire, many of their administrators sought after justice and fair play. But General Dyer blackened the history of British justice for all time. 1,650 rounds were fired. According to British estimates, 379 people, including children, were killed, and more than 1,200 wounded. Jallianwala Bagh, a modest courtyard in a simple city, is important because it symbolizes the conflict between sanity and reason on the one hand and violence and inevitable disaster on the other. It was here that Christ was crucified. It was here that Gandhi was assassinated, and Kennedy and Martin Luther King. The massacre at Jallianwala Bagh is a flashpoint in the history of many millions of struggling human beings. This is Sardar Deva Singh, an eyewitness.
Of Guruji went to the Bagh to attend the meeting. When the troops arrived, we were about 100 yards away. The troops began shooting ruthlessly and indiscriminately. I and Hazura Singh ran towards the Bagh. But Sardar Hazura Singh was shot in the belly. He died there and there. At that time, the bullet passed through my right shoulder here. I fell headlong in the street.
On the following day, even as relatives mourned their dead, General Dyer declared that for him, Flanders and Amritsar were synonymous. people were publicly flogged in the streets. In the narrow street of Khu Korean, where Miss Sherwood had been attacked 9 days previously, residents were chosen at random and made to crawl on their bellies for 150 yards. Among them were six young boys who were later publicly flogged. They were unconscious long before the flogging ended. Similar measures were employed in Lahore. In the town of Kasur, an open cage for human beings was constructed in India for the first time, the first concentration camp. There was no want of gallows. In the district of Gujranwala, aeroplanes were used to bomb helpless villagers. Among them were students playing a game of hockey. In the House of Commons, Mr. Asquith spoke of the brutality as being the worst outrage in the whole of our history. C.F. Andrews referred to it as a cold-blooded and calculated massacre comparable only with the massacre at Glencoe in Scotland. Sir Rabindranath Tagore renounced his knighthood. For Jallianwala Bagh was the flashpoint which convinced Gandhi that imperialism would never understand an appeal to the rule of law in spite of cooperation during the First World War. Henceforward, Gandhi was to be an implacable advocate of non-cooperation with the British government until independence was won. Because of widespread public pressure, the government was compelled to appoint a disorder inquiry committee under Lord Hunter. And before the Hunter Committee, Colonel Johnson said, "If I had the chance, I would do it again." The Congress boycotted the committee and appointed one of its own. Madan Mohan Malaviya was the chairman. The other members were Motilal Nehru, Gandhi, C.R. Das, Abbas Tayabji and M.R. Jaikar. Maulana Muhammad Ali said, "General Dyer fired not only on these people, but fired into our hearts." Lokmanya Tilak declared, "We shall continue our agitation for full responsible government." In the words of Gandhi, "No country has ever risen without being purified through the fire of suffering. Life comes out of death. Will India rise out of her slavery without fulfilling this eternal law?" The Congress session in Amritsar made it a more cohesive party with a definite program. Said Motilal Nehru, the president, "We want freedom of thought, freedom of action, freedom to fashion our own destiny." It was the tragedy of Jallianwala Bagh, the flashpoint, which intensified the freedom movement. The 1920 Calcutta Congress passed a resolution on non-cooperation and boycott of all foreign goods, a movement which shook the imperial edifice. In 1929, Jawaharlal Nehru, as president of the Lahore Congress, expressed the collective will of the Indian people when he said that the Congress stood not for dominion status, but for complete unfettered independence. A young boy, Udham Singh, had seen the massacre at Jallianwala Bagh. It became an obsession with him to hunt down the perpetrator of the tragedy. In 1940, at a public meeting in London, he shot and killed Sir Michael O'Dwyer. He was hanged. These are his fingerprints. Another Jallianwala Bagh was soon to shake the world. Fascism was about to usher in a time of unprecedented, calculated barbarism. When the people of India were asked to fight for the Allied cause, the Congress stipulated freedom as the price. When this proposal was turned down in 1942, the Congress launched the Quit India movement. Every leader of any importance was put behind bars, but the people carried on the struggle. The spirit of Jallianwala Bagh was revived. Over 1,000 persons were killed, and more than 100,000 went to jail. So it was that on the 15th of August, 1947, Jawaharlal Nehru said, "Long years ago, we made a tryst with destiny, and now the time comes when we shall redeem our pledge." The pledge was given and redeemed at Jallianwala Bagh. They had not died in vain, those unnamed martyrs. India was free at last. It is strange that the massacre of Jallianwala Bagh is celebrated with joy. This generation does not weep. It is proud of the courage of those who have gone before us. Today, when we witness the celebration of the freedom of India, we remember those who died, sons, daughters, and families, in the cause of that freedom.